So we want to quickly go in our subject. So today we are looking at our next in line. We had David and Solomon, Rehoboam, Abijah, or Abijam, and Abijam passed away, and now his son Asa becomes the king. His father was actually a good strategist and a good king. He's the one who defeated the kingdom of the north, the army, 500,000 soldiers that he wiped out in one battle, so that the kingdom of Jeroboam is now a weakened kingdom. So he was good in that. And King Asa inherited of 10 years of rest, 10 years of peace because of that victory of his father. But unfortunately, we have read that Abijam, the father, had followed the evil practice of his father Rehoboam. Grandfather and father did not really follow the Lord with what we call in the older Bible version, perfect heart or whole hearted devotion and loyalty to God. In other words, when in that time we use the expression perfect heart, we mean that these people have not fallen into idolatry. They have been loyal to God. That makes them inherit the title perfect heart. Their heart was to the Lord. They did not bend. They did not follow. And like in Solomon, and his, when he became a senior, and his years of being senior with all of his wives, that bent his heart. We have seen that in previous message. So today we're going to talk about a good king, King Asa. And King Asa did what was good and right in the eyes of the Lord his God. He took away the foreign altars and the high places and broke down the pillars. He commanded Judah to seek the Lord, the God of their fathers, and to keep the law and the commandment, and the kingdom at rest under him. So the first descriptions of this king is that he was doing good and right. A good king at last in that series. Second Chronicle has given us, and will continue like this, to give us a one sentence descriptions that summarize the life and the actions, the behavior, the achievement of all of these great leaders following and the descendants of King David. And it will be good or they will be evil according to that. And that reminds us that the measuring stick for a lifetime, it's not how people perceive you. God wants us in that series to get the idea that he is the measuring stick. And he is going to measure the worthiness of our lives, our actions, and our behavior. He wants all of us today to remember that. And King Asa, what he did, what that was right, he removed high places and places of worshiping false God. And he commanded Judah to seek the Lord. He broke the circle, the evil circle of idolatry that was spread in the country. He broke that circle of doing evil as the father and as the grandfather. And as they said, they didn't have a perfect heart. So this king break that cycle. He comes in and he is different. And last year at one point, last week, we discussed about the two level of responsibility. And one very important responsibility is parental responsibility, that the legacy that we passed on, the legacy of faith that we passed on, that we transmit values and by our example, that is the greatest way to transmit value system. And the second level of responsibility is the individual responsibility and personal responsibility. We cannot all blame it on the parents. We have our own decision to make. Amen? So Asa understood God's vision and God's desire for his people. So as a result of that, there was prosperity and peace in the land. Second Chronicles 14, 6 and 7. King, even though there was 10 years of prosperity and peace in the land, he did not just sit down. He was a great leader. He's a builder. He's got with a vision, and he knows that Israel is a small state. There are enemies all around. So he will use these years of peace to build protection, and he does it very, very successfully. He built 45 cities for the land at rest. He had no war in those years. Why? For the Lord gave him peace. And the Lord is blessing. And he said to Judah, let us build these cities and surround them with walls and towers, gates and bars. The land is still ours because we have sought the Lord our God. We have sought him, and he has given us peace on every side. So they built and they prospered. And this is a very important expression. We have sought the Lord. He understood that seeking the Lord brings peace. It brings good years. It brings blessing. It brings prosperity. But he did not remain passive. He knew that it's time to prepare for the future, strengthen the military, build defense cities, and all of this. But the most important things that I think we learn in this text here is the focus. The priority of this king is seeking the Lord. That he realized, he understand, and you will see this morning that this expression, seeking the Lord, becomes like the main theme, the main topic, the main priority of King Asa, to seek the Lord. And seeking here means not only like a general seeking, but it's seeking with care, seeking with the heart. Seeking also means to live and abide, obey, follow what the Lord wants, and to consult and to seek the wisdom and the direction of the Lord. So he's done that. And he inherit a period of prosperity similar to the prosperity that his great-grandfather Solomon had inherited in that time. And we learned that he successfully built 580,000 trained soldiers. So he has built a good military to protect the land. And then years passed. And then there is an army, 10 years. And it's one thing that I want to draw attention upon this morning is that it seems that the rule of this king is quite long. His fathers before him ruled for 3 years only. The one before, 17 years. But he's going to rule for 41 years. So it seems that as we read his life story, you have like slice. The first 10 years, and then 25 years later, and then the senior years. So we will have an evaluation of how well he's been doing during that period of time. So here, the first 10 years, it's been great. It was a time of peace, a time of prosperity. He built a military. He built fortified cities. The country was doing well economically. Everything was great. And then a big army just came. Zerah, the Ethiopian, came out against them with an army of 1 million men and 300 chariots. And it says thousands of thousands. That's the original text of the Bible. It means that they were outnumbered. It was like a huge, huge army that came. So what does he do? He just doesn't go with better military planning and give an inspiring speech to his soldiers. He just cried out to the Lord. And I think this prayer is exemplary. We need to learn. This is a wonderful story. I really enjoy studying this great king. Simple, devoted to the Lord. And if you look at his prayer, you will see how he prays. Oh Lord, no one but you. And we want to face some of these. Oh Lord, no one but you can help the powerless against the mighty. Help us, oh Lord, for we trust in you alone. It is in your name that we have come against. Oh Lord, you are our God. in a short prayer, there's a lot of declaration of trust, of relying upon the power of the Lord, depending upon in the name of the Lord, you are our God. So if you are facing difficult situation in your life, just do like Asa has done. Go and confess your powerlessness. Tell it to the Lord. Trust, confess your faith, confess your hanging to the Lord. It was great this morning the way we ended up our seeking His face this morning. We ended up our time by declaring faith about different things. And it was very uplifting for those of us who were here this morning to do that as we were closing our time of prayer this morning. Asa prayed for God's help. So don't give up. Don't be afraid. Just trust in the Lord. Admit that you are helpless. Admit your weaknesses. Admit the power of the Lord over the power of your enemies. And trust in the Lord. And the result of this prayer is actually mind-blowing. It's like you have a million army, and it says, the Lord defeat them. And this is amazing. It's the glory doesn't go to the military. The glory goes to the Lord. The Lord defeated them. And He gave them not only that, but a huge plunder, vast amount of plunder. Again, it adds to the glory of the Lord. So we have in this 10 years slice of his life, a humble king that seek the Lord, cry out to the Lord. And then just after this great victory, there's this man of God that comes and he is going to speak to the king. Then the Spirit of God came upon Azariah, son of Oded, and he went out to meet King Asa as he was returning from the battle. Listen to me, Asa, he shouted. Listen, all you of Judah and Benjamin. The Lord is with you or will stay with you as long as you stay with him. If you seek him, he will be found by you. If you abandon him, he will abandon you. And I was really realizing something this morning as I was reviewing. The Spirit of God shows up in the Old Testament. The Spirit of God, it's amazing how it is encouraging to see the Spirit of God. He comes in. He comes in, why? If you remember the previous teaching, there is no Holy Spirit coming to the rescue. There is no Holy Spirit coming to reveal and to warn people. There's no Holy Spirit because the people were not seeking the Lord. They didn't have a perfect heart. They didn't have a heart that was committed to the Lord. So they were doing their things, and they were even worshiping or letting go or participating into idol worship. So there was no Holy Spirit coming in, speaking through. But here you have the Holy Spirit. He comes when you seek the Lord, when you are relying upon the Lord, when you are looking to the Lord with expectation, you will see the Holy Spirit coming through. Azariah is not named as a prophet, but he sure is a man that is spirit-filled and spirit-led. And he is an advisor. King Asa surrounded himself with good advisors, and he remained teachable, and even after great victory. Sometimes, you know, great victory, great moment of success brings pride. But he, at this point, he remains really humble. And he had good advisor, godly advisor about him. And I want to make a point about this here. What a blessing for pastors and church to have godly advisors and godly influencers around us that are there, that you can count on, that people who care for the church, people who care for who we are, what we stand for, people who pray, people who are there to encourage you understand the problems, understand our weaknesses, but does not participate into criticisms and division. Instead, they are godly advisors. They are godly influencers. So when they address problems, they have solution, they have inspiration. They are there for the building up. They are there for the unity. And what a wonderful things it is for a church to be advisors and influencers like that. May we see that in Lighthouse. Amen? Amen. Among those who serve here at Lighthouse, advisors, influencers who are spirit-led, filled with the love of Jesus Christ, who know how to influence, know how to build up, encourage and advise, how it is a beneficial to one another in our conversations when we stand together. And when you address and you are aware of problems, you are there to do something that will transform, equip, and all this. It's wonderful. So this man, Azariah, has a message from God burning in his heart, and he does not hesitate to come. And then the message is very clear. If you seek him, he will let you find him. I like some of the way that the King James, sometimes I look at modern Bible version, I like the easiness of reading, but sometimes I go back to the way that the King James says it, and most of the time I like the strength, the clarity of this. We could say, if you seek him, you will find him. That's great, that's already positive. But I prefer when it says, God will let you find him. I prefer that. It's God who gives us the privilege. It's not me finding God just like in my own will, in my own times, and whatever I do. No, God has some sorts of conditions, prerequisites, he's looking for certain kind of hearts and attitudes. So there are some conditions in which God will allow us to find him. And sometimes God will hide himself and not let us find him. So I like this text here, because it says, if you seek him, he will let you find him. He will let himself be found by you. I really like it. And I think it's really important. As I was reading, someone was commenting, God gives us what we want from him the most. You want from your heart to find him, he will see that it is really, you're serious about it, you really want God, more of God in your life, he will let you have more of himself. Isn't it? It goes with the heart. It goes with the heart. You have the heart for God. God will let you approach him and find him. If he gives more to the heart that seeks him more, he also gives the heart that rejects him what it desires. The heart that doesn't care for God, the heart that rejects God, the heart that neglects God, he also gives to this heart what this heart is searching for. You don't want God, you don't find God. You will not find God in this way. So it's only the mercy of God also that allows us to find God. I like another quote from Mr. Morgan, a great theologian. He says, he revealed a philosophy of life under the control of God. It represents God as unchanging. God doesn't change. All apparent changes on his part are really changes in the attitude of man or woman toward him. Man with God finds God with him. Man forsaking God finds that he is forsaken of God. So God doesn't change, but situation change. You want more of God, you can find God. You don't want more of God, you don't find God. So that is what we find from Asa. And then the Azariah continue and gives them a little history lesson here. For a long time, Israel has been without. Look at what they were without. Without the true God, without a teaching priest, and without the law. There was times and the sad story, dark stories of Israel where they didn't have the closeness, the intimacy, the presence and the glory of God. They didn't have teaching. They didn't have a temple. They didn't have an altar. It had been neglected and they were without the law. And this time they were in trouble. They turned to the Lord and sought him, and he was found by him. You will find it a repeated topic in the story of Asa, the seeking God and the finding God. You will see it repeatedly as a main idea that is carried through this whole series of texts. And in those times, there was no peace. God was not blessing them. But now the message to the king Asa, but as for you, as for all of us here, be strong and courageous, for your work will be rewarded. There's an encouragement to each one of us. With your heart, you seek the Lord, you want to really walk faithfully with the Lord, there will be a reward. Because that's the nature of God. God rewards those who earnestly seek him. That's part of who God is. We read it in the New Testament, we find it in the Old Testament. And there's a great reward promised to Asa, and we will see it in the next slice of his life. 25 years, that's a big promise, and that's a big reward. The first 10 years was blessed and prosperity. The next 25 years will also be prosperity and blessing and peace to him. So how did the king respond? He took courage. Hallelujah. Asa heard this from Azariah the prophet. He took courage and removed all the detestable idols from the land, repaired the altar of the Lord. I did not know that, but at that time, says he repaired the altar. So what happened to the altar? Where was the altar? If the altar was broken, where were the sacrifices? Where were the things that they were supposed to do to honor God, and the morning sacrifice, the evening sacrifice? So he had to repair the altar of the Lord. Then Asa called together the people of Judah and Benjamin. But you know that there was a division, the northern kingdom. So now that the land is prospering, there is peace in the kingdom of Judah, there are many who are migrating south. It says the people of Judah and Benjamin, along with the people of Ephraim, Manasseh, and Simeon, who had settled among them, for many from Israel had moved to Judah during Asa's reign when they saw that the Lord his God was with him. Hey, these are good years. There's a blessing. There's peace there. There's prosperity. There is work. The economy is doing fine. Let's move and let's find some better work over there and better living conditions. But the king responds and taking courage. He's really motivated and he does even more. Remember when we started the life of King Asa, he says he removed the high places and all the worship locations of the false gods. So now he's doing even more. He's doing more of that. His zeal is being renewed. And you and I, we need these moments of renewal. And as we follow the Lord, you need to meet the Holy Spirit. You need moments where the Holy Spirit comes with power over your life. Like you read in the book of Acts that they were being filled again. There's more than one filling of the Holy Spirit. And we need to be renewed. We need to be refreshed. We need to go through times of refreshings in our Christian life to be more effective. He took courage and he does even more than before. His zeal is being renewed. Many people had migrated south because there was prosperity. He rebuilds the altar of God. Amen. 2 Chronicles 15:12. And he leads the people into a covenant to seek the Lord. Again, this expression, to seek the Lord. Let us seek the Lord. That is so important, the God of their fathers. And look at this beautiful text. They entered into a covenant to seek the Lord with all their heart, and with all their soul. And you will find in this text double blessing. The first blessing of seeking the Lord is that they experience joy. How many of you have lost the joy of your salvation? You've lost the special sparks, the rekindling. You need some rekindling of the fire, the flame of your love for the Lord Jesus and all these. So they make a covenant. They decide, they determine with all of their heart, the desire of their emotions. They go to the Lord. They want the Lord. And one of the first thing is the joy is back in their life. They rejoice in the Lord. Amen? Hallelujah. So we have a key for our life. And the second thing that we find here, they had sworn with all their heart and had sought Him. Again, this expression, they had sought Him with their old desire, and He was found by them. Again, the same. You will see it repeated over and over. They had sought Him with all their heart, with all their emotions, and He let them find again. Wow, wonderful promise. And then the Lord again give them rest all around. No more war for 25 years of peace in the land. Many people find it difficult to commit to something. It's hard to commit, to take a pledge, make a covenant, make a promise that you, Lord, here I am. Lord, I want to do more. Or commit to people, commit to certain cause or something. Many people prefer to be indecisive because we are afraid of responsibility. But Asa here, guided by the prophet's word, the Holy Spirit, they declare themselves for God. They make the decision. Wholeheartedly, they commit to please the Lord, and the result is peace for the nation. So if we want peace, check in our heart first. Where is our commitment? If we lack commitment, amen? Because peace seems to be, according to our story this morning, a byproduct of being wholeheartedly following and loyal to the Lord. Amen? Hallelujah. Oh, it's not all. He's really responding to this word of the Holy Spirit in his heart, and he goes even further. And verse 16, yes. King Asa even deposited his grandmother, Maacah. Deposed. Yeah, deposed. What did I say?
Deposited.
Deposit, yeah, deposit. Okay. Yeah, go to the bank. Go to the bank. Deposed his grandmother Maacah from her position as queen mother. And some of your Bible, it will say his mother. But actually, you remember last week we had a slide and we went to the mothers and the grandmothers and we look at them and their influence. So she was actually his grandmother. She was the mother of his father. Aha, you know that. And she was not a godly person. She was a granddaughter of Absalom. And so her influence and her heart was not there. So even though his dad is not the king, the grandmother still alive. So she still retained like a high position in the kingdom, a position of influence. She's the queen mother still. So he deposed of her. Wow, that is big. Think about in that time it happened. He deposed of her, and not only that, he does it publicly in the view of all people. He take her pole of the Asherah, which was like some sorts of female divinity of sensuality and things like this. He cuts it down and he does it publicly, and he destroy it in the valley of Kidron. And it's done publicly. So he's serious about his commitment unto the Lord. So we see in verse 17, am I at the right place? Yes. The pagan shrines were not removed. from entirely from Israel. There's a few ways that we can read that here. But last night I observed something that made sense, because I did not understand that verse. Because we have read that at the beginning, he removed all of these places. Then we read just before that, that again, after the word of the prophet, he does it even with more zeal. He goes back to doing it even more, and he removes the worship of the false gods, every place. And now it says that the pagan shrines or the high places were not removed. Aha! But you need to read from Israel. They were removed from Judah, but not from Israel. Last night I was struggling with another way of reading it. The pagan shrines, although the pagan shrines had not yet, had not been removed entirely, nevertheless, his heart remained perfect or loyal to the Lord. So that's how I was reading it until I paid attention to the to Israel. He cleansed the land and Judah, but in Israel, they still are there. But anyway, here we can find that his heart remains right for the Lord. Amen. Praise God. Asa's heart was holy through all of his days. That is what we are finding. He takes all the spoils, the treasure, silver, gold, utensils, and Judah offer it to the Lord, and then there's 24 more years of peace. Now we come to the senior years, and we are going to finish with that. But there is some trouble in the senior years of this great king, the final account of Asa's life. We should be grateful for the honesty of the Bible. Because when you find heroes of faith, we would prefer to hold on to how great our heroes are. But God is so truthful, trustworthy. He tells us like it is. So the leaders and even the heroes of our faith were real people with complex personalities. They went through events in their life that made them make certain decisions like we do. And sometimes their flaws will be revealed at that time. 26 years have now passed since the defeat of the Ethiopian's army under the power of God. The kingdom of Judah have prospered in every way. And then, yes, okay. In the 36th year of reign Asa, Baasha, king of Israel, came up against Judah, fortified Ramah as a military outpost in order to cut off all traffic in and out of Judah. So, king is coming and now is going to oppose the success, and he doesn't want his people to move anymore. And he's blocking the trade routes of the other people, the roads and everything. He interrupts Judah's trade routes. So what should Asa do? He had a great military win before because he relied upon the Lord. So in that case here, will he do the same thing? Will he again seek the Lord? Instead, he calls the king of Syria, a pagan king, and he makes a treaty with them. And not only that, but if you pay attention to the text when you read the story, he takes from the treasures of the temple money that belongs to the Lord, and he uses it with his own money, money from the king, from the taxes, and then he gives it to this king. And actually, it is... if we use human logic, it makes sense. There's a reason why he's done that. If you go back to the previous king, his father had destroyed 500,000 professional soldiers from the kingdom of Israel. So they were weak. They could not go there and attack Judah. because their army had been destroyed by the father of King Asa. So the only way that they could bring some sorts of opposition to Judah was with a treaty with the Syrians. So King Asa, quite smart guy, says, okay, they come with me, they cannot do it on their own, they need the king of Syria to help them, so I'm going to bribe the king and break their treaty so that the king of Israel cannot do anything with me. So then we'll be. So it makes sense. It's just a logical thing, a political approach. Just bribe them and we'll be safe because they cannot be a military force against us. But God didn't like that. God saw because of the previous wind and before. God had a plan. God had a plan. But because of his lack of faith and his compromise. At that time, Hanani the seer came to Asa, king of Judah, and said to him, because you relied on the king of Syria and did not rely on the Lord your God, the army of the king of Syria has escaped you. I won't stop here. God had a plan. But because of human logic, this plan is not going to come to pass. We've lost a blessing. We could not receive the benefit of what God intended to do. If you would have trusted in the Lord, God had a plan to destroy that army from the enemy of Israel and Judah. But now it's not going to happen because he compromised these things. God had a plan, but Asa didn't know. And I want to bring a point to us this morning about the seriousness when we don't rely on the Lord sometimes. This is a very serious consequence of not relying on the Lord that we find in that story. Because God had a plan behind the scene that we didn't know. Know that in Isaiah we read that the ways of the Lord are higher. His plans, his ideas are greater. We don't get it. We don't know it unless you seek the Lord, unless you wait upon the Lord, unless you allow the Lord to come to the rescue and to do his work supernaturally, you will not know. So it's easier, according to our own human logic, take the matter into your own hand and settle your own problems if you have any type of resources to do. But sometimes we would miss not relying on the Lord might have consequences instead. And that was an evidence of the spiritual decline of King Asa. His confidence in God had slipped away and he only sought human solution to his problem. And not only that, but you find something where before, when Azariah came to him, he had been very humble. He had been accepting the word of the Lord, and he has been like responding with renewed zeal. And here he responds with anger, and he arrests this prophet, puts him in shackles in prison, and he will mistreat many people in the land. Something has happened in his heart. We don't know, the Bible does not tell us exactly, does not explain what, but there's definitely a change, something dramatic that has taken place in the life of man. We see now the true condition of his heart has changed. Actually, it is not a sin to use human means to solve our problems. We all do that and it's okay. What is the sinful part of this is that when we trust the human means more than we trust God, or that we will ignore God completely from the problem-solving process, when we will not bring God in. And then I want to finish with this awesome verse. I hope you can all see this verse here, verse 9. for the eyes of the Lord. This is a speech that Hanani, the seer, is giving us. Okay, let's read it. At that time, Hanani, the seer, came to Asa, king of Judah, and says, because you rely on the king of Syria and did not rely on the Lord your God, the army of the king of Syria has escaped you. Were not the Ethiopians and the Libyans a huge army with very many chariots and horsemen? Yet, because you relied on the Lord at that time, 25 years ago, he gave them into your hand. For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong on behalf of those whose heart is perfect or loyal to him. You have done foolishly in this, for from now on you will have wars. So let's read verse 9 again, because that is so awesome. For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong on behalf of those whose heart is loyal to him. What a wonderful verse to finish. And we learn something. It is part of the rebuke. It is part of God speaking to the Lord about, to the king, about he acted foolishly. You see, the Ethiopians, we won because the Lord gave you, you relied on the Lord, and now you have done this, you have acted foolishly. And then we have this wonderful verse, for the eyes of the Lord run through and fro. But I want to pay attention in closing to this verse. Sometimes we say, okay, the eyes of the Lord run through and fro. And he says, yeah, of course, the Lord is checking you out so that if you do something wrong, it's going to hit you on the head or somewhere else. So, no, if you read and pay attention to this verse, the eyes of the Lord run through and fro. Why? Why does what is he looking for? What are the intentions of the Lord to do that? He's looking for people anywhere all the time. He's looking for those whose hearts are perfect or loyal to him. He's looking for hearts. Can he find your heart? And among all the hearts that he is searching for, the eyes of the Lord is searching for hearts. But the intention for which he's not looking for hearts to punish, he's looking for a heart to reveal himself strong. You need help? I'm here. You can count on me. I'm trustworthy. I'm available. I want to be available. I want to show myself strong to you. I want to be there when you need me. But I'm looking for your heart. When I see your heart is loyal to me, you can find me. I thought this is the one most wonderful verse in that study yesterday. The Lord is always watchful for occasions of helping the faithful. He is there when you need him. He's not away. He's looking for your heart. You just need to show him your heart for those who sincerely commit themselves to the Lord. Amen? So in closing this morning, what happened to our King Asa? At the end of his 2 years later, in the 39th year of his reign, he developed a serious foot disease. Some people say that it was like a form of diabetes because he died out of it. It was quite a serious. Yet even with the severity of his disease, he did not. The man who started his life by commanding to Judah to seek the Lord, at the end of his life, does not seek the Lord. He has become an angry, bitter man. And one of the exhortations that we need to take to heart this morning is something that we need to learn. Age and time does not necessarily make us better. It should, actually, because we have experience, we have life experience, we have had the wisdom of God, we have had good moments with God, so we should actually have become better. We should have prospered. We should have enjoyed the Lord's provisions, the Lord's prosperity. We should have seen the Lord move over. We should become better, but not necessarily. it will be better, your life will be better, you will become better only at one condition, is if you continue to seek the Lord all of your days. If you continue to have a heart that is considered by God perfect, if you continue that act of continuing will determine whether you will become better in your life in the eyes of God or not. All in all, Asa was a good man, but he did not finish well. And the last year of his life were marked with unbelief, hardness against God, oppression against his people, and disease. You know, the name Asa means healing. That was a good name, to heal the land and to go into prosperity. And so I want to finish positively with these scriptures here as a review of the main scriptures of that you see in the life of Asa. Let's read these texts here. 2 Chronicles 14:4. Asa commanded Judah to seek the Lord. Verse 7. The land is still ours because we have sought the Lord our God. We have sought him and he has given us peace on every side. 15:2. If you seek him, he will be found by you. 15:15. And all Judah rejoiced over the oath, for they had sworn with all of their heart and had sought him with all of their old desire. And he was found by them, and the Lord gave them rest all around. For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong on behalf of those whose heart is loyal to him. Would you please stand?